So here are the seven reasons that I think you can tell people that you stand in support of Israel. And I know there'll be skeptics out there, and that's okay, but I would like to reemphasize, I wish I had never had to deliver that speech. I wish I didn't have to go around the country delivering this speech over and over again, but I do, because people don't know how to argue the case for Israel. And if you can't argue it, you will never be successful in getting support for them. The first reason is, of course, the most logical reason, and that is all the archaeological evidence supports it. Every time there's a dig in Israel, it does nothing but support the fact that the Jews have had a presence there for 3,000 years. They've been there that long. The coins, the cities, the pottery, the culture. There are other groups that were there too, but there is no mistaking the fact that the Jews have been present in that land for 3,000 years, and it predates any claims that other peoples in the regions may have. The ancient Philistines are extinct. Many other ancient peoples are extinct. They don't have an unbroken line to this date that the Jews have. Even the Egyptians of today are not racial Egyptians of 2,000 or 3,000 years ago. They are primarily an Arab people. The land is called Egypt, but they are not the same racial and ethnic stock as the old Egyptians of the ancient world. The first Israelis are, in fact, descended from the original Israelites. So the first proof and the reason to support Israel is the archaeological evidence. The second proof of Israel's right to the land is the historic right. History supports it totally and completely. We know there has been an Israel up until the time of the Roman Empire. The Romans conquered the land, Israel had no homeland, and although Jews were allowed to live there, they were driven from the land in two dispersions. One was in 70 AD, and the other was in 135 AD. But there was always a Jewish presence in the land. The Turks, who took over about 700 years ago and ruled the land up until World War I, had control. Then the land was conquered by the British. The Turks entered World War I on the side of Germany. The British knew they had to do something to punish Turkey and also to break up that empire that was going to be part of the whole effort of Germany in World War I. So the British sent troops against the Turks in the Holy Land. One of the generals who was leading the British armies was a man named Allenby. Allenby was a Bible-believing Christian. He carried a Bible with him everywhere he went, and he knew the significance of Jerusalem. The night before the attack against Jerusalem to drive out the Turks, Allenby prayed that God would allow him to capture the city without damaging the holy places. That day, Allenby sent World War I biplanes over the city of Jerusalem to do a reconnaissance mission. You have to understand that at the time, the Turks had never seen an airplane before. They looked up in the sky, and they saw these fascinating inventions flying around, and they didn't know what they were. They were terrified by them, and they were told that they were being opposed by a man named Allenby. By the way, in their language, that means the man sent from God, or prophet from God. They dared not fight against a prophet from God. So the next morning, when Allenby went to take Jerusalem, he went in and captured it without firing a single shot. The British government was grateful to the Jewish people around the world, particularly to one Jewish chemist who helped them manufacture nitre. Nitre is an ingredient that was used in nitroglycerin, which was sent over from the New World. America sent it. But they didn't have any way of getting it to England. The German U-boats were shooting at the boats, so most of the nitre ended up on the bottom of the ocean. But a man named Weizmann, a Jewish chemist, discovered a way to make it from materials that existed in England. As a result, they were able to maintain their supply. The British at the time said they were going to give the Jewish people a homeland. That is all part of history. It is all written down in history. They were grateful that the Jewish people, the bankers, came through and helped to finance the war, and the homeland that Britain said it would set aside consisted of what is now Israel and all of what was then the nation of Jordan, the whole thing. That was what the British promised to give to the Jews in 1917. In the beginning, there was some Arab support for this action. There wasn't a huge Arab population in the land at that time, and there's a reason for that. The land was not able to sustain a large population of people. It just didn't have the development that it needed to handle those people, and the land wasn't even wanted by anybody. Nobody wanted the land. It was considered to be worthless land. Mark Twain said, and of course you may have read Huckleberry Finn and Tom Sawyer, and you know Mark Twain, Samuel Clemens, took a tour of Palestine in 1867. And this is what he described the land as looking like. We're talking about Israel now. He said, quote, "A desolate country whose soil is rich enough, but is given over wholly to weeds, a silent, mournful expanse. We never saw a human being on the whole route. There was hardly a tree or a shrub anywhere. Even the olive and the cactus, those fast friends of a worthless soil, had almost deserted the country," end quote. Where was the great Palestinian nation? It didn't exist. It was not there. Palestinians were not there. Palestine was a region named by the Romans, but at that time it was under the control of the Turks, and there was no large mass of people there because the land would not support them. And this is the report that the Palestinian Royal Commission, created by the British, made. It quotes an account of the conditions on the coastal plain along the Mediterranean Sea in 1913. This is what the Palestinian Royal Commission said. "The road leading from Gaza to the north was only a summer track, suitable for transport by camels or carts. No orange groves, no orchards, no vineyards were to be seen until one reached the Yavneh village. Houses were mud, schools did not exist, the western part toward the sea was almost a desert. The villages in this area were few and thinly populated. Many villages were deserted by their inhabitants." That was in 1913. And the French author Voltaire described Palestine as a hopeless, dreary place. In short, under the Turks, the land suffered from neglect and low population. That is a historic fact. The nation became populated by both Jews and Arabs because the land came to prosper when the Jews came back and he began to reclaim the land. Historically, they began to reclaim it. If there had never been any archaeological evidence to support the rights of the Jews to the territory, it is also important to recognize that other nations in the area have no long-standing claim to the country. Did you know that Saudi Arabia was not created until 1913? Lebanon until 1920? Iraq did not exist as a nation until 1932? Syria until 1941? The borders of Jordan were established in 1946 and Kuwait in 1961. Any of these nations that would say Israel is only a recent arrival would have to deny their own rights as recent arrivals as well. They did not exist as countries. They were all under the control of the Turks. Historically, Israel gained its independence in 1948. The third reason, so you have archaeological already, and you have historical. The third reason that the land belongs to the Jews is the practical value of the Israelis being there. Israel today is a modern marvel of agriculture. Israel is able to bring more food out of a desert environment than any other country in the world. The Arab nations really ought to make Israel their friend and import technology from Israel that would allow all of the Middle East, not just Israel, to become an exporter of food. Israel has unarguable success in its agriculture. The fourth reason I believe the Jews have a right to the land in Israel is on the grounds of humanitarian concern. You see, there were 6 million Jews slaughtered in Europe in World War II. The persecution against the Jews had been very strong in Russia since the advent of communism. It was against them even before then under the Tsars. These people have a right to a homeland. If we are not going to allow them to have a homeland in the Middle East, then where? What other nation on earth is going to cede territory, is going to give up land? And they're not asking for such a great deal. The whole nation of Israel would fit into the state of Oklahoma 7 times. It would fit into the state of Georgia 8 times. They're not asking for a great deal. The whole nation is small. It is a nation that, up until the claims started coming in, was not desired by anybody. The fifth reason that Israel ought to have the land is that she's a strategic ally of the United States. Whether we realize it or not, Israel is a detriment and an impediment to certain groups who are hostile to that which makes us the greatest nation in the history of the world. They have kept them from taking complete control of the Middle East. If it were not for Israel, they would overrun the region. They are our strategic ally, and it's good to know that we can count on one country in the Middle East. They vote with us in the United Nations more than England, more than Canada, more than France, more than Germany, more than any other country in the world. The sixth reason is that Israel is a roadblock to terrorism. The war we're now facing is not against a sovereign nation. It is against a group of terrorists who are very fluid, moving from one country to another. They're almost invisible, and that is whom we are fighting against today. We need every ally that we can get. If we don't stop terrorism in the Middle East, it will again be on our shore. We have said this again and again, and on September 11th of 2001, it was proven so. One of the reasons I believe the spiritual door was opened for the attack against the United States of America is the policy of the government asking the Israelis and demanding with pressure not to retaliate in significant ways against the terrorist strikes that have been launched against them. Since its independence in 1948, Israel has fought four wars. The war in 1948 and 1949, that was the war for independence. The war in 1956, the Sinai Campaign, the Six-Day War in 1967, and in 1973, the Yom Kippur War, the holiest day of the year, and they were attacked. And those wars were with Egypt and Syria. You have to understand that in all four cases, Israel was attacked. They were never the aggressor. Some people may argue that this was not true because they went in first in 1956, because they knew at the time that Egypt was building a huge military to become the aggressor. Israel, in fact, was not the aggressor and has never been the aggressor in any of the four wars. And by the way, they won all four wars against impossible odds. They are great warriors. They consider a level playing field being outnumbered 2-1. There were 39 Scud missiles that landed on Israeli soil during the Gulf War. Our president asked Israel not to respond. In order to have the Arab nations on board, we asked Israel not to participate in the war, and they showed tremendous restraint and did not. They stood back and haven't done anything over those last attacks, and we criticized them. We criticized them in our media. Local people on television, radio often criticize Israel, never knowing the true facts. We need to inform them. We need to write letters to the editor. We need to call up television stations and radio stations and tell them to report the news accurately and not to continue to show a Palestinian picture which is completely fabricated by the media. I was so thrilled when I heard a reporter one day pose a question to then Secretary of State Colin Powell. He said, "Mr. Powell, the United States has advocated a policy of restraint in the Middle East. We have discouraged Israel from retaliation again and again because we said it leads to continued escalation, that it escalates the violence. Are we going to follow that preaching ourselves?" To which General Powell replied, "We will strike back, and we cannot tell Israel not to do it." But all that changed, of course, in December when I stood on that street corner, when the Israelis went into the Gaza with gunships and into the West Bank with F-16s. And with the exception of the May before last, the Israelis had never used F-16s, not since the Six-Day War. And I'm proud of them because they are trying to stop terrorism. It is not going to go away on its own. If Israel were driven into the sea tomorrow, if every Jew in the Middle East were killed, terrorism would not end. You know that in your heart. Terrorism would continue. So it's not just a matter of Israel in the Middle East. It is the heart of the very people who are perpetuating this stuff. Should they be successful in overrunning Israel, which they won't, they should be. It would not be enough. They will never be satisfied. And the final reason, the number seven, is the one that I believe most strongly. I believe that Israel has a right to the land because God said so. If you look it up in the book of Genesis, it is right there. It says, Genesis 13, 14 to 17, the Lord said to Abram, lift up now your eyes and look from the place where you are northward and southward and eastward and westward. For all the land which you see, to you will I give it and to your seed forever. Arise, walk through the land in the length of it and in the breadth of it, for I will give it to you. That's God talking. The Bible says that Abram removed his tent and came to dwell in the plain of Mamre, which is in Hebron, and built there an altar before the Lord. Hebron, of course, is now in the West Bank. It is at this place where God appeared to Abram and said, I am giving you this land. The land he was standing in, where the tomb of the patriarchs is, was Hebron. This is not a political battle at all. It's a contest over whether or not the word of God is true. The seven reasons I am convinced clearly establish that Israel has a right to the land. And now I believe it's up to us to make sure that we are clear as to what those reasons are when we talk to people. Because I watch it over and over again. People will immediately, you send your kids, you know, I'll just give you the anecdotal story now that pains me to tell, but I tell it nonetheless. In those early statistics, we talked about all of the Jewish children who go off to Ivy League colleges. Well, I sent my two children off to Ivy League colleges. My daughter to Columbia University. She went on to Stanford Medical School. My son to Harvard undergrad. He went on to Yale Law School, where every attempt was made by the faculties at those universities to convince my children that Israel not only doesn't have a right to exist, but that somehow it's the most horrible nation on earth. And this goes on in these institutions every single day, and our children don't know how to answer them. And that's why I'm committed to not just doing this speech in front of people who I know already know, but doing it in front of college campuses where I'm not particularly welcome, and encouraging young Jewish students who are filling those wonderful Ivy League institutions to fight back and to not allow them to tell them that there is a people called the Palestinian people. The original Palestinian passports were issued to the Jews in Israel. There is no such thing as a Palestinian people. To be a people, you have to have a language, you have to have a currency, you have to have a government, and none of those things exist in the so-called Palestinian people. And now they have what purports to be a government, and that government has said repeatedly, when it's not in front of American cameras, that the complete and utter destruction of Israel is the only goal that they have. They do not want Israel to exist, and that's the bottom line. So when we send off our kids, our young adults, to these wonderful institutions that literally emptied my 401k, but now my children are my 401k, when we send them off, we need to send them off knowledgeable, and they need to know who their friends are in the community. It is incredible to me that week after week I stand on the corner with giant banners saying we support Israel, and I stand there with 16 Christians and 3 Jews. That's a powerful statement. I live in Broward County, which is one of the most heavily populated Jewish communities. I speak in front of temples, I speak in front of Jewish high school classes, and yet nothing seems to be able to move them to the importance of having that word out there, that message out there, that Israel matters and that there are people in the United States of America that support it completely and wholly and will until it is sitting in the proper position, being lauded for its successes instead of condemned for its attempts to defend itself. I thank you for letting me speak today. I encourage you to educate yourselves. Some of you know a lot of this history. I saw a lot of heads nodding. Some of you, it may be the very first time you heard some of this history. You need to know it. Read about it, Google search it, do whatever it is that you can, and then you have to take the next step. You have to tell somebody else. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity today.